Hello again, everyone. Welcome back to the second part of this lecture on material selection. In this part of the lecture, we're going to pick up from where we left off last with the translation part of a material selection exercise, and the result of which generates a performance index. We're now going to cover how to screen, rank, and validate a selection for a given application. A structured material selection approach coincides with an overall design process. All materials are up for consideration, and the first step is to translate the design requirements into an index that permits screening of all of these materials into some subset, which then in turn can be ranked in terms of applicability. Finally, the ranked materials are then validated for this applicability. The performance index is the main outcome of this initial translation step, and is the critical thing which is required for these subsequent steps. It typically takes on the form of one property, P1 in this case, raised to some power, alpha, divided by another property, P2. In an earlier example, the value of alpha was 1. However, there are other translated use cases where alpha is not equal to 1. Let's now look at some of those. We've already seen the performance index for a simple tie. And you might have already seen the derivation of performance index for the deflection of a beam in the center here. The performance index for the bending of a panel can also be derived in similar manners. For many engineering applications, making very stiff components, that is, resistant to deflection or elastic deformation, is desirable, as is minimizing mass. The performance indices associated with maximizing stiffness while minimizing mass is given below for each of the types of the components described above. These are applicable on the basis of their strengths already been decided, as well as some of their geometries being set. Relating these back to the original general form of the performance index, P1 here is the modulus of elasticity, P2 is the density, and alpha ranges between 1 for a tie through to 1/2 for a beam and 1/3 for a panel, on the basis, again, of strength being defined. What if strength mattered instead, with the modulus fixed? Well, if the modulus is fixed, then the stiffness, too, is fixed on the basis of geometry. To maximize strength and minimize mass, then these performance indices are used for each of the components described. It's still P1 raised to some power divided by P2, but P1 is now a failure stress, in order to be a broader descriptor beyond the yield strength to account for all material forms. The values of alpha change, whereby it ranges from 1 to 2/3 to 1/2. This is down to the relative differences in cross-sections for each of the parts. Complete derivations of the tie and beam are available elsewhere. Let's go ahead and apply one of the performance indices associated with maximizing stiffness while minimizing mass. Here's a simplified logarithmic plot of elastic modulus versus density for most material systems that we've talked about in this course. The bubbles encompass all potential properties and may not be populated everywhere with specific materials. These few bubbles can, however, encompass hundreds, if not thousands, of different materials. We may plot our performance indices pretty much anywhere on this plot, as long as they have the correct slope. For example, a slope of 1 for a simple linear relationship between elastic modulus and density can be drawn anywhere. So too can a line corresponding to a panel. It will need to have a slope of 3, however. The same is true for a beam. We can draw a line anywhere on the plot corresponding to this index, as long as it has a slope of 2. Let's look at why that is. Using our performance index for a beam, we can break down the steps and meaning behind drawing this construction line. Rearranging the expression for the performance index, one takes the logarithm of both sides and isolates the logarithmic expression of the modulus of elasticity, which is dependent on the density and the performance index. From this manipulation, you should be able to observe how the factor of 2 comes from the 1/2. This is the expression which is being plotted here. It has a slope of 2, which describes the relationship between modulus and density, and has an intercept of 2 times the logarithm of the index. However, if unconstrained, the index can change, which means that the construction line on this plot is free to move vertically along the y-axis. This is how one applies the performance index. You can see that for a given density, say 1 megagram per cubic meter, and a given modulus, there are no materials that are suitable for a given application. For a tie, one needs to increase the density by a certain amount before suitable materials are available, and similar conclusions can be drawn for the other component configurations and their respective performance index. We are now in a position to start screening. If you know what the performance index is, then you can jump to the general form of this type of construction and set up for screening. Plotting the performance index alone in this manner does not uniquely identify any singular group of materials. All it does is identify a relationship between material properties. We need to apply some constraints that can be viewed in concert with this relationship. We can slide the performance index line up and down and can draw it anywhere as long as it retains the same slope. We can then apply a second line corresponding to one of our constraints, such as that which corresponds to a minimum elastic modulus. This line can move up and down as well, according to the constraint prescribed, but moves up as our minimum stiffness increases. The combination of both the performance index and the constraint now defines a search area. This search area now allows us to disallow or screen materials which are not suitable for the application. The constraint identifies a minimum stiffness and provides a lower bound. However, since the performance index is free to move, it does not identify a material with a minimum density. This is why we need to rank our materials which appear in our search area. Say that we have only identified 4 materials that are available to us. Remember, these bubbles corresponding to the varying material classes can contain many, many materials which may or may not be available. So this may be a realistic scenario. The performance index line can be shifted to include all 4 for consideration, such that the search area contains the choices available. 2 metals, materials A and C, and 2 composites, D and B, are to be considered. We go back to our objective for ranking, which is the best choice. For the current example, this is to minimize mass. Therefore, on the basis of density, the best will be B, followed by D, C, and then A. If the objective, and not constraint, is to maximize stiffness, then the ranking would run the other way, with A being the best choice down to B. All the materials which are constrained in the search area will have the same relationship between modulus and density, corresponding to a minimum acceptable modulus. What happens if we need to consider multiple performance indices? If you recall the basics of pressure vessels from an earlier lecture, there are 3 main performance indices that can be employed when selecting a material for them. If one wishes to minimize the wall thickness of a pressure vessel regardless of flaws, then the performance index is simply down to the failure or yield strength described by M1. If one wishes the pressure vessel to yield before it leaks, that is, the failure mode will be plasticity and not fracture, then a second performance index is a linear one, as described by M2. Finally, if one wants the failure mode to be decided by fracture as opposed to plasticity, then M3 applies. There are design rationales behind each of these. For some pressure vessels, leaking will rapidly decrease the internal pressure and therefore be less deleterious than failing by global plasticity. However, if the consequence of a leak will be worse than the vessel failing by plasticity, well, you get the idea. However, with our performance indices, we can actually apply all 3 at once. Plotting the logarithmic relationship between fracture toughness and the failure or yield stress, we can apply the same approaches as before. Starting first with M1, having a yield strength greater than a particular value, all of the materials that correspond to this. Next, we can apply M2. This further constrains the material choices. Finally, we can apply M3. In the locus where the label M3 is located, it can be seen that there is a conflict between M2 and M3. For the parameters given, M3 is more permissive than M2. That is, for a failure stress of approximately 10 MPa and a fracture toughness of 1 MPa root meter. By juggling all of these at once, we can arrive at both a framework for deciding which materials are best suited on a fracture properties basis, as well as minimizing wall thickness. Furthermore, a potential locus of materials, which can be employed to satisfy both yielding before leaking, as well as leaking before yielding, which will be the strongest and the most flaw tolerant. We can then rank the materials according to which is more important, either yielding or leaking. It might seem that this is the culmination of this entire approach, but there is one more step, validation. Selecting the best material according to properties doesn't always assure viability. There are other factors to consider. Once a material has been selected, then a very common follow-on is to consider economic cost. The good news is that if the basis is to minimize mass, then the material cost can be factored in directly to performance indices and therefore the plots of the properties to directly compare them. However, that's not the only external consideration. Even if a material is available and cost-effective, can it be processed efficiently? For example, the design requires that the component is welded, and the material is not suitable for this type of processing. Or the effects of processing will affect the structure and therefore properties and hence performance. However, this isn't the biggest factor. There is one which overrides almost all of these factors. While there is an economic cost associated with the use of materials which is nebulous, there is a real cost in terms of the energy employed to produce or reprocess materials available for selection. While a jewel costs money as well, it costs different amounts of money depending on where you go in the world, and the same is true for engineering materials. Here is a plot of the varying energy content versus engineering function. I've plotted wood here not to advocate for its use, but as a point of comparison. Ultimately, this type of cost has to be factored into any component, regardless of what the intention is. For example, does the design case of a metal with a particularly high embedded energy content to save a tenth of what it costs to energetically produce make any sense? Validation can be seen to answer immediate questions. Does the design meet requirements, match the problem statement, and is it cost-effective, etc.? But one cannot ignore externalities which mark the validation part of a material choice. The larger issues with validation are those which have implications on the life cycle of both the component and encompassed materials, and how these affect sustainability. So, what we've covered in this part of the lecture is the application of a materials performance index, the relationship between one or more material properties for a given application. A methodology for simultaneously considering multiple performance indices at once has been presented. These indices, along with constraints to screen materials and ultimately validate down to a singular choice. And in choosing a material, you should now know a lot more about why materials have the properties that they do, both at the very small microstructural level up to the very large component level. So too are the implications of employing materials in your future designs. What might be considered a singular component or assembly, in fact, is a lot more behind it in terms of energy employed to initially manufacture them and the product life cycle. The ability to simultaneously think both big and small is genuinely the mark of a good engineer, and I hope that I've been able to give you some new insights on how to do so. So that's it for Materials 1. Congratulations on getting here. Maybe we'll meet soon enough for Materials 2. But until then, take care.